nothing is getting better. It's getting, well, it's going exactly where we forecast. I mean, it wasn't, very difficult to do. You just had to add one to one and understand the weather, understand ocean currents, understand the nuclear reactor melting down and melting through its containment and into the underground. Who knows how deep? And to understand that there was an underground water flow, a river, as it were, coming from the mountains behind. And that river passed right through the molten core of each reactor that melted down and is going into the Pacific around the clock. That hasn't slowed down. In fact, we think it's actually speeding up. There is also the airborne emissions constantly, not only at Fukushima, but at all the municipal trash incinerators in Japan. That's how they get rid of a lot of their waste. They burn it. Well, each city has been asked to carry its fair share of the waste problem. And so it's being burned all over Japan. And where does that smoke go? It goes up into the air. Have you heard one report about that on the news? Has there been one outrageous statement made by anybody that this can't go on? No, there's no outrage anywhere. This is brand new. This is big. And it has to do with what we have feared would happen. Is a looming catastrophe here in the U.S. And you're saying probably, well, what are they talking about? What we're talking about is, believe it or not, an underground fire burning. It started at a waste site in St. Louis, and it's been burning and working its way toward a nuclear burial site where they have weapons-grade plutonium, apparently old bombs buried, and the fire is only 1,200 feet away from this plutonium waste. You remember what happened in New Mexico near Los Alamos, okay? This is going to be, if this fire reaches this plutonium, God only knows what could happen. The world is literally on the brink of another nuclear disaster. Beneath the surface of a St. Louis area landfill lurk two things that should never meet: a slow-burning fire and a cache of Cold War-era nuclear waste separated by just 1,200 feet. Authorities have quietly adopted an emergency plan in case these smoldering embers reach the waste, a potentially catastrophic event that could release radioactive fallout in a plume of smoke over a densely populated area of St. Louis. The plan for a worst-case scenario was developed only a year ago and never publicized until this week. I assume that the fire continues to reach closer and closer, and that's the reason for the announcement. If that fire reaches the waste, this is a quote now, there is a potential for radioactive fallout to be released in the smoke plume and spread throughout the entire region. All right? So all of you folks in the St. Louis area, in St. Louis County and east, depending on the weather, of course, maybe right now as we speak, months or a year, or we don't know how long, that close to a catastrophe. Go ahead, Yochi.
Yeah, that's you're talking about, more than 300 yards. That's on the surface. This is a methane fire, landfill, all the garbage over the, maybe a century of garbage down there creates a huge amount of gas, and the waste, as they put, layers of dirt over garbage, sort of compresses that gas, and the compression itself makes it hotter. And so, therefore, you sort of see this gas, it's like if you had a balloon and you put a rubber tire on top of it, the balloon will flatten out, and the pressure, it will start to release, it will break somewhere and release gas out. So we have no idea how close it is underground.
We don't know. You're right.
The gas is under.
It could happen next week.
It's hard to stop this gas, right? You can pump water in there, but the methane will be resistant. It'll just work its way around.
Yeah.
Well, it'll just work its way around. It'll find wherever there's any airspace. It's going to go around.
Right.
It'll burn through the plastic down there, whatever's down there. It'll go right through gravel and so on. So,
What I'd like to know. Go ahead. Finish up, then I'll carry on. Go ahead. We're on the telephone.
The amount of war grade nuclear waste, basically warhead material, is 6,700 tons. We're not talking about pounds or kilograms. We're talking about tons.
That's what I wanted to get to.
Northern Hemisphere. I mean, not just the United States, not just Missouri, but the entire shebang could go up if that stuff starts, if the methane gets in there.
He just made some astonishingly critical points. You cannot stop a gas from migrating underground. It's burning. It'll go wherever the resistance is least. No one can go down there and control it, put it out, or otherwise stop it. And it is going to come up to the surface if it ignites this plutonium. And you heard right. Now, who in their right mind would do this, and how many people in St. Louis even knew about it? 6,700 tons of weapons-grade plutonium warheads buried near St. Louis. 6,700 tons. All right, that's Dana Durnford on. We got Dana. Yochi's dropped off, so Dana's there. Yeah, it's 6,700 tons of weapons that were buried in the Cold War. God only knows why or how the decision was made to put it anywhere near an urban area, and it's only the fire burning is a gas. It's methane gas, and it's burning in strata in the ground. The gas will find its way through the most porous rock, okay, and it'll carry the fire closer and closer. It's only 1,200 feet away. Yep. It started out as a waste dump catching fire, and the waste was decomposing and creating methane gas. Well, it started to burn horizontally underground. That's our measurement of 300 meters, 1,200 feet. So we don't know how close it is underground. And if it ignites that stuff underground, you're going to have smoke that will work its way to the surface and begin to pour out. How long will it take 6,700 tons to combust? And how much could that do to the Northern Hemisphere in terms of catastrophic?
Up to 200,000 times hotter. So it's very volatile. Its parent daughter is a gas.
This thing is a monster, Yochi. This is another Fukushima of a different color.
Well, it depends on the stuff that are there, but this is like stuff from the old days, from the 70s and 80s. So we don't know if they're proper, stainless steel casts with all sorts of linings and all that. If it's waterproof, if it's rusted proof, we're going to have the same problem as we did in Fukushima. If it rusts through and these things have been sitting in water, you're going to see a lot of tritium, deuterium formation down there, which is those fires in Fukushima were like super, they call them hydrogen fires. Yeah, it's true that, tritium and deuterium, do have hydrogen at them, and they're just like water does, but it's supercharged. It burns a lot, tritium will burn a lot hotter, and it's radioactive. It will release, of course, a lot of beta rays. So there's a lot of massive amount of radioactive isotopes that are heating up the whole zone. So, from DOE on what kind of casts are down. How do they bury them? Are there steel drums? How thick are these casts? How waterproof are there? There's a lot of water down there.
Okay, let me read.
And water is no guarantee of safety. Water could be the thing that triggers these things like we saw in Fukushima, these huge explosions then cause trigger fissile reactions. And if it's all underground and under pressure like that, you can see this whole thing just blow up and lift the whole, throw dirt into the sky, 100 meters into the sky.
I can't even imagine.
The Department of Energy has a lot of they have a lot of explaining to do. They have to come up and, dig out the records and tell us what kind of cast this stuff is buried in.
Okay, let me, they're going to tell us the truth. Missouri Attorney General Chris Koster said, and this is just about 4 weeks ago, several things. Number one, Drs. Joel Birkin and Shoaib Shoaib, I guess it is, S-H-O-A, Shoaib Usman, at the Missouri University of Science and Technology. These are the best in the area. Found, pay attention, contamination in the trees on the property of neighboring landowners. These findings indicate the off-site migration of radiologically impacted material, RIM, R-I-M, either in the groundwater or the aerial transport of particulate matter. Now, that's just a standard kind of dispersion from these insane waste dump sites for nuclear weapons and plutonium and uranium and you name it. They bury it thinking it's going to go away. All right, here's more. Doctors Tony Sperling and Ali Abedini concluded that the fire has moved beyond both lines of gas interceptor wells that have been dug, obviously, to try to pull that gas up to the surface and stop it migrating underground. It has been seen now and is believed to be moving in the direction of the OU-1 radiological area. Number three, Todd Thalhammer, a civil engineer with extensive experience investigating landfill fires, concluded that what he described as a catastrophic event at the landfill was foreseeable and preventable, but hasn't been stopped. Dr. Timothy Stark, PhD and professional engineer, observed significant slope degradation and areas where the waste mass had settled, suggesting the underground waste had been consumed by the smoldering combustion fire down there. These reports underscore what has been clear from the beginning. Republic Services does not have this site under control, said the Attorney General. It appears that it has poisoned its neighbors' groundwater and vegetation. I'm going to stop right there. You begin to get the picture. It's like a layer cake. The land, as you dig deeper, has different measures and levels of porosity, and the gas will find the easiest way to move horizontally along. And I don't know how deep this is, Yochi. You came up with 6,700 tons. The Missouri senator...
Yeah, and now, now the dangerous thing is that there is radiation in the water, as these scientists in the field have measured.
In
the groundwater, that means the gas are leaking. That means they're leaking probably, not only is water leaking, in other words, the gas are leaking, there's water going through the gas. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Which means there's tritium and deuterium and plain old hydrogen gas down there in a deadly mix that's ready to explode. You know, the water is no protection against fire. The water brings on. It creates these gases, which are highly volatile because they're not just hydrogen. They have a higher burning temperature, plus the fissile material there. And so, so our worst fears are right there. The radiation is coming out of, leaking into the air out of these vent pipes and out of the drainage pipes. And, you know, you see drain pipes out of landfills. As rain comes down, you got drained water.
There is,
in other words, tritium and deuterium in that material, which is flammable, highly flammable, and fissile, and can trigger whatever plutonium or uranium in there. You know, if you get that fire going fast enough, enough tritium is burning, is energized, is releasing as a gas into those casks. There's nothing to prevent a fissile event. Once one cask blows up, it can trigger a chain reaction right down the line. Yeah?
We had a similar event at Los Alamos where the casks exploded because of the packing in them. Now, it was an organic cat litter is what it was. Get this one. Here's one more I have to read.
Yeah.
Missouri State Senator Maria Chappelle Nadal said on September 17th, quote, there are references that are in the reports that the Attorney General did with independent scientists where they say that what we have under the ground could end up as another Chernobyl. What I am concerned about are the 40,000 tons of uranium that have been spread all over the place. We're talking about the most potent uranium in the world. We're looking at cancer clusters. We're looking at the number of children who have double sets of teeth, children who have missing eyeballs, the number of children who have brain tumors. This is not consistent right now with a normal community whatsoever. They're already seeing the results of this horror that someone has perpetrated on St. Louis County in Missouri. Who did it? When was it done? What were the casks made of? Probably 55-gallon steel drums, something like that. How deep were they buried? This, now, you've got 6,700 tons of plutonium. And Dana Durnford, we now have a report from a Missouri state senator of 40,000 tons of uranium that have been spread all over the place as well.
Well, all over the place, I think she means all over the United States at various dump sites all over
the
U.S.
I hope so.
This is a one-time bomb that is getting set off. You know, she means it's probably dozens more. You know, maybe
well, I hope
more,
I hope so. But
like this,
all right. I'm just
and
reading the quote. So
August, they catch on fire. You know?
Yeah, Dana, go ahead,
those,
Dana.
This is an old landfill.
Yeah.
Well, 6,700 tons is 14.7 million pounds, and 40,000 tons is 88 million pounds. And a pound of this, if you put it into a theater, it will kill everybody in the front row in a minute. And if there's 300 people there, they're dead in 20 minutes. And you can clean the theater out and exterminate every human on the planet with that single pound. So what would 6,700 tons catching fire will do besides the damage we already
One pound of plutonium will kill everybody on the planet.
Yes, right? Sir. Yeah, and all the animals, too. It'll do
that's
it.
That's the end of the planet. All right. So what we've done here, this stupid, asinine, allegedly sentient species, has created in this. How many other environments are there like this around the country? Who buried these weapons grade plutonium casks near St. Louis? 6,700 tons of it. You need 1 pound of plutonium to kill everything on the planet. Okay. Do you understand what we're talking about, dear ladies and gentlemen? Wherever you are in the world, this is of keen interest to you, critical interest it should be. Go ahead, Yochi.
Yeah, now you wonder, why does this thing burn out of control? You got to remember, in those days, and I don't know if still now, because I'm sure illegally it's done, we're talking about rubber tires. You know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of rubber tires are buried inside America's landfill. And when those start burning, you can't stop it. Nothing can stop it. You know, it's highly combustible, it's super toxic, and
correct.
It just keeps burning and burning, melting and burning, melting and burning along. So this is like we're not talking about, waste paper. We're talking about an absolutely intense underground fire that generates, it doesn't need a lot of oxygen. You know, it's a chemical fire, basically, because of the rubber tires. It's not a normal fire like with wood or paper. It's a chemical fire that's going on. It's a chemical process.
Let me tell you one other thing.
All sorts of toxins.
Yeah. Here's a quickie. It's not known, but maybe Dana's heard about this. I don't know. It's a very little known fact that one of the most, in fact, far more toxic than automobile exhaust are the vapors that come off a rubber tire at speed on a roadway. That tire wears out and that rubber turns into a gas. And that gas in micro concentrations is far deadlier than any waste that comes out of an internal combustion engine. Go ahead, Dana.
What Yoshi was saying was that about fire underground, well, these vapors, these noble gases, what they need is oxygen. They don't need a flame. They can actually combust just by coming in contact with oxygen. And so these release noble gases, so all the casks are venting all the time. And if not, they would detonate on their own at some point. And it would then the rest of the area would be, you wouldn't be able to go near it. And that's what we've seen happen basically anyway, like you guys were saying. And the same thing with rubber tires, and, you know, like they complain about people smoking, but if you stand alongside of a vehicle for a few moments, you are getting a wicked, unbelievable, imaginable attack up on your immune system and your whole body that'll stick around for years. And so it's just that I'm shocked that there's so much, this 6,700 tons, I wasn't quite up to speed. And yeah, no, this got me shocked.
Yochi, where did you get that figure, 6,700 tons of warhead material?
I think there was a report in 2013. The fire has been burning for years, and that was the estimate back then.
Yeah.
And so it is a sizable amount. I mean, the one solution on the temporary, it's not a solution, but to stall the chemical release and this the heat coming across, it's called plating. You get these huge steel plates, and you drive them into the ground, one after the other, down deep, to make a steel wall. And now temporarily hold it. But the problem of the rubber underground chemically, it will probably corrode through steel, eat through it eventually, and especially if it's hot, if it's burning, and it'll burn through. It will give the DOE, let's say, a couple more years to dig out the nuclear waste and move it. And pity the poor guys who are going to have to do that job, but it's got to be done. You know, it's a lot of weight. And basically, a lot of Missouri is going to have to be evacuated. Anything in the path of the taps coming out, they're leaking, you know, whole highways, freeway, you know, they're going to have to just be closed maybe for, you know, next 10,000 years. There's going to have to be a death strip there so they move it out of the way of this fire and then repack it in the new cap. And the danger, again, is if it's leaking tritium and hydrogen, explosion in the air. You can dig the stuff out, but it could explode in contact. As Dana said, that's what happened at Fukushima. As soon as this gas gets in contact with air, it explodes wildly, making huge arcs of electricity along these powerful flames. If everyone remembers how the spent fuel pool burned at reactor 4, it was like incredible flame just going out horizontally. You know, it was just massively. It was just burning out meters. You know, shooting out of there. You know, so.
All right. What we have here is something, as I read to you, that is already polluting, which indicates to me that the casks have decayed, some of them at least, or whatever they're in, and has polluted the neighboring parcels of land. All right? You heard it. It's in the vegetation. It's in the soil. Those people, if I were there, I would get the hell out of there immediately. This is not panic time, but it is panic time because we are facing a situation that could be so catastrophic. She mentioned Chernobyl. You see, now that woman should have mentioned what? She should not have mentioned Chernobyl. She should have mentioned Fukushima if she wanted to make an analogy. But she doesn't know because the American media has delisted or blackballed any coverage of Fukushima. So her frame of reference is Chernobyl. She doesn't understand that Fukushima is pouring radiation into the ocean. It's in the atmosphere. It's in the rain. It's in St. Louis. It's in her backyard. She doesn't know it. So there's another part of this story. Dana, go ahead.
Let me remind everybody that that this whole industry is based up on a lie, and that everybody that's listening to it, the media is going to, anytime there's an accident, they're going to tell you it's like a banana or a potato chip or walking in the sunshine or getting on an airplane. And they've been doing this for 70 years, but they actually know the difference, and they do that on purpose to reinforce that lie. And so like what Jeff is talking about and Yoshi's talking about and he's passionate about and has articulated so well, is a call to action for everybody out there that this is the time to do things and time to talk sense and time to think about and reflect on what is it we're gonna, is our legacy, and is our legacy just the end of society and end of everything? We are the last stand of this planet. Make no mistake about it. We're looking at an extinction event playing out in the Pacific Ocean, and we have all these sites that buried on the ground. They buried it under the ground, Jeff, because it's unstable already, right? That's why they got rid of it. Go ahead, Jeff.
Yeah. This is amazing. Do we know, Yochi, much about this burial site? I don't.
No, there's not a lot of information. The fire was known, but the details of the closeness and all the distance to the site. That just came out this last week. So this thing has been hushed up by the Department of Energy. So they're not setting up. And when they're talking with some scientists, find radiation in neighboring sites. Obviously, neighbors were complaining, right? Some sort of deforming. There must be some ground neighboring property owners. You know, maybe they have cattle there or sheep or something, and they're noticing deformities and they complain. This is not a city block. These are huge tracts of land. So the spread of the radioactive material is vast. So we don't know the dimensions of the site. The government, the state government, the city government, no one's talking. I think it's time for people to, you know, tell us what's going on because it's a real threat. And she's right. And she says Chernobyl, it should have been Fukushima because Fukushima is a closer model where you have these tritium, deuterium fires. There's got a lot more information on what's done, so other scientists can come in and try to figure out, engineers figure out solutions. I think plating is the first thing they got to do, just to slow this thing down, so they can begin to figure out how to deal with this, how to pump out that tritium. They're going to have to pump it out somehow. I don't know how they're going to do that, but you know, it's a monumental task, and it is going to be not as complex as Fukushima, but it's going to be very, very difficult to do. Radioactive gas, radioactive explosive gas, it's going to be easily a several billion dollar project to deal with that.
If this actually ignited, I don't know how much mass or force it would have under the ground. I'm wondering if it's buried 100 meters deep or 10 meters deep. I don't know. And it could blow right up through the surface.
Yeah, if it triggers basically a thermonuclear reaction, tritium can trigger, you know, the tritium gas, especially in a very hot environment. And it's already hot because it's pressurized underground. But in contact with chemical fire, it can trigger a chain reaction. And that's the problem. Once gas caps start blowing up, you do have a massive, serious problem, and you can't get to it. You know, there's like, you know, meters and meters, you know, tens of meters of dirt and soil, you know, of soil and garbage or whatever they put over the site on top of those nuclear caps. So it'll be very difficult to get to. So, and then the underwater leakage program, you know, this is St. Louis is right there by the Mississippi River, right? It's at the confluence of the, you know, it's where the Mississippi gets big. We're talking about groundwater already reaching the neighbors, okay, which are like at least probably a quarter mile, half a mile away.
Yeah.
So it's already in the groundwater. If this thing explodes, there goes the Mississippi, you know, all that stuff. Just like Fukushima in the heart of a leakage, a water leakage in the heart of the United States, okay?
Wow.
Very wet, humid area. As you know, Midwest is not like California. It's not drought-stricken. Lots of rainfall, snowfall there. You know, it's right there in the basin of the Mississippi River, in the heart of America, not that far from Chicago, you know, Memphis, places like that. You know, it's in New Orleans downstream, and, you know, how many American towns and cities downstream?
Okay,
let me read. It will be a Fukushima in the heart of America.
I'm going to read this. This will answer the question. What is OU-1? The West Lake Landfill is an unlined landfill and Superfund site located in Bridgeton, Missouri. In 1973, it leached barium sulfate residue originating. No, it didn't leach it. They buried it there, apparently. Leached, this is what they call it, leached barium sulfate residue originating from the Manhattan Project was combined with topsoil to dilute the contaminated material and illegally dumped. The landfill is divided into multiple sectors within which are two highly radioactive operable units, OU-1 and OU-2, which both contain the same combination of highly radioactive material. Although barium sulfate cake residue is the only compound recorded to have been dumped in 1973, soil samples indicate the presence of many more radioactive materials, including uranium and thorium, along with their decayed compounds. OU-1 covers 940 cubic yards on the surface, based on soil depth of 6 inches or 150 millimeters, and 24,000 cubic yards altogether subsurface. Now, these are older estimates. This is called the West Lake Landfill. It has a smoldering fire located only, now this story says, 1,000 feet away from OU-1. If the fire were to reach this area of radioactive waste, radon would be released into the air, resulting in high levels of radiation for the surrounding areas. Now, this is from Wikipedia that I'm reading, okay? I think that they're leaving a lot of material out. I think they're not saying things they should be saying here. The smoldering fire, they're saying, on December 23rd, 2010, methane extraction wells from the dump reported rising temperatures. Further investigation revealed elevated hydrogen and carbon monoxide and reduced methane levels in extracted gas, suggesting a subsurface smoldering fire event, an SSE. A subsurface smoldering event or fire occurs deep within a landfill and produces no visible flame or smoke. Instead, this form of combustion is slow and moves wherever it wants to, basically. The smoldering fire is located 1,000 feet away from OU-1, raising fear about the consequences the county of St. Louis will face if the fire reaches a toxic material. Now, Yochi, again, if you joined us late, has a figure of 6,700 tons of plutonium-grade weapons. Now, this is crucial. And if that's true, and he heard it, this is a lie, another cover-up. They put this stuff in there, and they never told anybody. Go ahead, Yochi.
Yeah, if you're barium sulfate, from pure processing, we're talking about, common most, radioactive isotopes. In other words, there's already free-flowing radioactivity all over the site from barium sulfate. It must be a large volume of, but it also forms isotopes. So the sulfur is also dangerous. Barium sulfate, both a powerful oxidant. The sulfur will just, as you know, it will turn eventually some of that into sulfuric acid. It'll eat through these caps. Basically, we've got a chemical stew there, a witch's brew, which the caps are doing, and the sulfate, we would have to be sure is not really well contained. If they found it that long ago in the 80s, early 80s, stuff was in the 55-gallon barrel. So the stuff is basically on the loose, highly oxidizing. It'll create rust wherever. Not rust, but it'll just basically burn through metal. So these casts of nuclear warhead material are sitting right now in an underground radioactive lake.
The barium sulfuric
acid boiling all around it. It's just a matter of time before this thing's going up. Huh?
The other problem, and we'll go to Dana here, is that this stuff, the leached, was mixed in with the topsoil to, quote, dilute it. Utter insanity. It's already a Superfund site, but it's worse than a Superfund site by miles. Go ahead, Dana.
And every time there's a controversy around waste sites, they say it's radon is released. And so it's just the opposite of saying it's bananas, potato chips, and walking in the sunshine when it comes to radioactive fallout, right? But it's the same thing. And so that's not going to happen. Radon is not a byproduct of a chain reaction. And so, but that's the lie they tell everybody. And they've been doing it 7 years, so it works. Who knows?
Yeah.
So anyway, out here, now we have no snow in the mountain, folks. And like me, we were talking about this a number of months ago, how the tritium, and Yoshi brought that one up, how the tritium doesn't allow the ice to crystallize. We've actually lost the snow in all the mountains in British Columbia, and that's gallows laugh. But now the blowback from that is right away here in the animal kingdom, here, right where I'm to. And there's around 50 bear sightings just outside the town here in the last week or so. And the bear scat, the bear poo, they're only eating apples. Now, there's no berries left out there. They failed this year because of the strange weather. And there was no snow in the mountains. And so the snow cools the rivers down and regulates it, folks. And so there's no fish and no salmon survived this year. So,
the bears are existing on apples back from orchards and apple trees, random apple trees. And they're moving closer to the town for potentially more
food.
Every garbage can.
And everybody, there's signs everywhere from wildlife now, bear in the area, just everywhere you go. And so it won't be long now before they were going after people and going after pets and stuff like that before fall, within the next couple of months, yeah. So very bad prospects. And then it's going to be really hard to make it through the winter like that. Because normally they would go up, a lot of these would go up into the mountains and hibernate in the winter.
Well, they can't build up a layer of fat on apples. They need a lot more sugar, like from the berries. So they need salmon. They need protein. They need a lot of stuff.
Right.
There's no able to hibernate, basically.
Or berries. So berries, fish, and even meat is their normal diet. And apples is a treat. And so right by what you're saying. And that's the result of Fukushima. And so the global warming is not saying anything about all the snow missing from the mountains, British Columbia. You think they would be out using that to bludgeon everybody out there with. And this is dramatic not to have snow. We've never seen it. Anybody's not familiar with that. Is the whole coastline now. I've just done 5 expeditions, but the last one at the end of summer, and all summer long, it should be snow in the mountains. You should be able to go up in the skidoo, go skidooing, or go skiing, or go snowboarding, and come down and go swimming in the pond in the middle of summer because the snow never disappeared. It's gone throughout the entire country.
Now, what you're saying here is doubly fascinating. Because the global warming kooks are not seizing upon the fact that you've got no snow up there in the mountains, because the obvious answer to it is Fukushima. And they're losing a golden opportunity to play their global warming game. That's really amazing.
And locals everywhere are asking that question. What's going on? They don't know what to make of it, and they can't find anything on it. Dramatic. And just a side note on what Yoshi was talking about earlier, 6,700 tons. Now, I got some headlines. I was looking for that while we were doing it. But I do remember a few days back, the headline was that the town close to it has unsealed evacuation orders. And if the wind, maybe, or something like that could be a factor coming up in the next week or so, shifts in the wrong way, they're going to evacuate that town. Fukushima, of course, it has really devastated the entire coast of North America and the Pacific Ocean permanently. There is no way to recover that ocean. And so we gotta have conversations about this on this planet really soon. We're running out of time. And as you talked about many times in Yoshi, how the oxygen is being depleted on the planet, how there's 1,800 autoimmune deficiencies will show up before cancer shows up, and everybody's focused on that little tiny part of the diseases that are associated with radioactive fallout, and that, you know, there's a proliferation now of bad things in weather and everything else. It's really coming to a boil with all these other waste sites going down, nuclear plants are not being rebuilt, and then truth is finally starting to rise and show its evil head. And, you know, these people are accountable. They're out there everywhere in the media is propagating the lie. And at some point, she's going to boil over in the next year or two, is my opinion. And while Yoshi's talking about tonight, that could be the one that could trigger everything, because that is catastrophic, 14.7 million pounds. My goodness, it's heartbreaking that there's no end to what they got done to us. We just
14 million pounds.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Would you call that uranium just as a simple handle, or what?
The majority of it, 97% of it will be uranium. and that, once again, this stuff got a 4.5 million year half-life, and that because it was bombarded with neutrons and it accepted extra electrons and now has new atomic weight, and nothing on the planet has encountered that particular element, and so everything is vulnerable to it. That's the problem with it. That's why we have terrorist laws and nuclear waste sites and everything else.
We're going to watch this Westlake landfill. 1939, it was created as a limestone quarry, but then landfilling trash, tires, etc., began in the 1950s, okay? So it's been there a long time. It also, a company involved, I won't get into all the names, dumped 8,700 tons, 7,900 tons of leached barium sulfate, and 39,000, make it 35,000 tons of soil mixed with it at the landfill. The leached barium sulfate was a byproduct of Mallinckrodt Chemical Works uranium enrichment, can you spell plutonium, program as part of the Manhattan Project and later nuclear weapons production. This is an old problem. It almost sounds like they just did whatever they damn well pleased, as they usually do, and this is turning into a horror. And I don't want to scare anybody, but we're already seeing pollution, nuclear radioactive pollution on the adjacent parcels of land to this landfill, which was apparently filled with God only knows what. We know the Manhattan Project was top secret. So they took all their waste somewhere, and this is one place they took a hell of a lot of it. Go ahead, Dana.
They have a notorious, unconscionable history of dumping it and burying it in communities, and all nuclear power plants are right on the ocean because you need enormous amounts of water to hide the crimes. And they call it diluting, but there's no such thing as diluting because the stuff never goes away. And so it just disperses. But its whole predication is based upon lie after lie after lie after lie. And it can't exist the minute you try to have a conversation without using the lies. You can't have a conversation about it.
I go back again to the Environmental Protection Agency. How many news conferences has the EPA held since Fukushima blew? Zero. None.
Oh, wow.
We are not to know. We are going to be sacrificed, just like the Japanese government is sacrificing the people who live near. Hell, Tokyo should be, by all rights, evacuated, okay? But
yeah,
they're not going to do it. Too much money. 30 million people, ain't going to happen. But we just don't figure in the scheme of things. Human life doesn't mean anything to these people. They're insane.
They got yourself in the corner, and you don't know how to get out of it.
And no, they do
there's
not.
There's no way to save face, right? There's no way to save face. And at some point, rather than save face, they're going to let it blow up in their face. And that's Coleman head on. There's no way to avoid it now. And that's why we see that police state now getting in gears. That's their hope that they can cower at us or corral us or anything like that.
Right.